حسین شہید شہید الحسین
ثم الصلاة والسلام على اشرف الانبیاء والمرسلین سیدی وحبیبی ونور قلبی طب القلوب ودوائها وعافية الابدان وشفائها ونور الابصار وضيائها ابي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين المهديين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا قال الله العلي العظيم في كتاب الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا إما يبلغن عندك الكبر أحدهما أو كلاهما فلا تقل لهما أف ولا تنهرهما وقل لهما قولا كريما واخفض لهما جناح الذل من الرحمة وقل رب ارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا صدق الله العلي العظيم. Tonight, our lesson from the ocean of Kerbala is about the importance of parents in Islam. How much Islam has given importance to our parents. In order to understand this, when you go to the Quran, there are many ayahs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks highly about the parents. But all of the ayahs that Allah talks about the parents, they all come along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means, every time Allah wants to talk about parents, He first talks about Himself and then attach Him to the parents. The verse that we just read is in Surah Al-Isra, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling all of us, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا. Your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has passed a law. The word Al-Qadha, meaning a law. Somebody who passes a law. Somebody who makes a law. Somebody who makes a judgment. That is why in Arabic, when we say the word Al-Qadi, meaning a judge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah, Surah Al-Isra, He says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا. That your Lord has made a rule that no one in this universe worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is where I want the world to hear this. Because some people think the followers of Shia, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, they're worshipping graves. A'udhu billah. We don't worship graves. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They think that when you go to ziyara and you make your dua and you pray in those places, they think you are worshipping the graves. No, we don't. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Islam, nobody is worthy of worship except Allah. It doesn't matter how great you can be. You're still not worthy for someone to worship you except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. After you serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you do what Allah asks you to do, Allah said the next responsibility is your parent. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ, your mother and your father. They deserve your kindness. They deserve your service. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clear here when he says, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah said, and be kind to your parents. But there are 2 points here. Point number one. When Allah said, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ, Allah did not specify if your parents are Muslim or non-Muslims. Which means, even if my parents happen to be idol worshippers, they were atheists, I still have the responsibility of honoring them. Got the word? Walidain. Quran did not specify they have to be mu'min, they have to be Muslim. No, there is no condition on that. Walidain, parent, period. The second lesson, it says, ihsana, be kind to them. See, it's amazing when you come to Islam. And many responsibilities in Islam that Allah put on us, he is specific on these rules and regulations. For example, Salat, Allah tells you, you do wudu, you face the Qibla, you read this, and that is what's called Salat. Anything out of it is called something else. Zakat is specified, Hajj is specified. But when it comes to your parents, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it general. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ أَحْسَانَ, which means be kind to your parents. Kindness means what? Buy them car? No. Build a house for them? No. Feed them? No. Take them to ziyarah? No. Hajj? No. Everything that is known as kindness, Allah said it's responsibility on your shoulder. But Allah did not specify. Not like salat or hajj or zakat. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانَ, be kind to them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not stop there. Then he says, إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرُ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. At some point, if one of them become advanced in age, they become elderly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us how to treat them. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرُ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us how we should talk to our parents. فَلَا تَقُلْ, do not say to them, uff. What is the meaning of word uff? The word uff, our Imam, the sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he said, Allah said the word uff, which is formed in Arabic with two letters, alif and fa, to tell us that every smallest word that you would say to hurt your parents, Allah said, you are not allowed to do so. Because you know, in Arabic, the shortest word you can form is two letters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the word uff is to say something very, very light, but it hurts their feelings. And by the way, you know the word uff? It came from the word when you blow something off your shirt. Right? When we blow, that's where the word uff came from. To get something away from you. Now from that word, they formed the word uff, which is the smallest word to hurt your parents or to make them unhappy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ. Do not say to them a word that will disturb their feelings. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Now here, Allah tells you two lessons. Lesson number one, how you should not talk to them. وَلَا تَنْهَرْ, also how you should not deal with them physically. وَلَا تَنْهَرْ, and nahar in Arabic, don't be harsh with them. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا, be gentle. Be nice and kind to them. See, the amazing in this verse, Allah teaches you what you should not say. Then He tells you how you should say it. It's like, He tells you, don't say this, but say this. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ وَقُلْ. Don't say this, but say this. What should I say? وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, always remember them in your dua. Never at any point of your life you should forget your parents. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And when you talk to them, not only you should make dua for them, when you speak to them, وَقُلْ لَهُمَا, say to them, the father and the mother, قَوْلًا, words, كَرِيم. You know, in Arabic, the word كَرِيم, it has different meanings. One meaning is generosity. One meaning here is precious. Like when he said, a gold is a precious stone. Diamond is a precious stone. Allah said to you, when you speak to your parents, وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا, meaning, find beautiful, precious words to say to them when you speak to them. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. That is when you talk to them. Now when I deal with them, He said to you in the previous ayah, وَلَا تَنْهَرْ, don't be harsh with them. Now how should I deal with them? He tells you, I said, وَخْفَضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلْ, put the wings of mercy for them. Now you know, here is the where the important lesson starts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us how to treat our parents. He said, وَخْفَضْ, الْخَفَضْ means put down. What? جَنَاح, جَنَاح means wings. Now, do we, anybody, any human being have wings? No. Who has the wings? Birds. Why would Allah use the word birds addressing human being? Because there are so many lessons we humans can learn from animals. That's when you go to the Quran, there are so many chapters in the Quran named after animals. One, al-Baqarah. One, al-Naml. One, al-Nahl. One, al-Fil. And so on and so forth. Allah named this surah, al-Ankabut is one of them. All after the animals. Why? Because there are lessons to learn from those animals. And tonight, we will learn from some of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَخْفَضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الظُّلْمِ, put the wings of mercy, humility for them. Now why would Allah say, use the wings in the Quran when He's addressing humans? Now those of you who watch Animal Planet, or when you look at the birds, learn something from them, from this verse. When you look at the birds, the baby bird in the nest of the mother kept there. The mother goes out to go find food. When the mother is coming with the food in the beak, look at the babies in that nest. What do? When the babies see the mother coming, they put their wings down to show their respect for the mother, for all the effort and all what she does for them. This is their way of saying thank you for the mother. Allah took that from the Quran, and Allah took that from those birds and said it to you in this verse. وَخْفَضْ لَهُمَا, put the wings like those birds as they put their wings for respect for their parents. Learn from them. And He says, جَنَاحَ الذُّلْ. الذُّلْ in Arabic means humility. You know something, brothers and sisters? You know, in Islam, there is one hadith from the Prophet where he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَوَّضَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ إِلَى الْإِنسَانِ. Allah has given everything to a mu'min that you have the right to do for yourself. But one thing Allah said, I did not allow a mu'min to do. What is it? To humiliate themselves in front of someone. That's why Imam Hussein says, هَيْهَاتْ مِنَّا أَذِلَّا. And he says, يَا أَبَى اللَّهُ لَنَا ذَلِكَ وَرَسُولُ. He said this. That is, we are not allowed to humiliate ourselves in front of anybody. No. That's haram on a mu'min. But this humility that you're not allowed, Allah said it's wajib to do it in front of your parents. You are not allowed to humiliate in front of anybody except your mother and your father. That's what I said. وَخْفَضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلْ, which means put the wings of humility for them. وَخْفَضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلْ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ, and be merciful to them. وَقُلْ رَبِّ رَحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse teaches us the importance of the parent. But now the question is, how do we respect our parents? You go to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein teaches us how to respect our parents. Number one, he said, never call your parents by their name. It's haram in Islam. As a matter of fact, in some hadith, they say if a child calls his parents by their name, it leads him or her to poverty. يُورِثُ الْفَقْرِ النِّدَاءَ الْأَبَوَيْنِ بِإِسْمِهِمَا يُورِثُ الْفَقْرِ, because Allah takes barakah from your life just by calling your parents by their name. And learn from Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, when you read Hadith al-Kisa, look at Ahlul Bayt as the great as they are, Imam Hussein and Imam al-Hassan. When they come to the house and they saw their mother, what do they call them in Hadith al-Kisa? As-salamu alayki. Oh, ya Fatima, oh ya Ummah. Oh ya Ummah. They never called her ya Fatima out of respect, even though they're imams. Imam al-Hassan comes, as-salamu alayki ya Ummah. Hussein, as-salamu alayki ya Ummah. Out of respect, they never called their mother Fatima by the name. That is a lesson from Ahlul Bayt. Never call your parents by their name. Even if they ask you, out of respect, never call them by name. That is number one. Number two, they said one of the things we should not do to show a respect for our parents is never walk in front of your parents when you walk with them. You know, sometimes when we walk with our parents, because we are still young, we can run, and our elderly father, he has to struggle and catch up with us. That is against Islamic teachings. You have to let them be ahead and you be behind them. Yes, in certain situation, if they ask you to lead, that's one thing. But if not, in the normal circumstance, you have to walk behind them and let them take the lead, so they can walk freely without being pressured. That's number two. Number three, do not sit while they are standing. You know, when we go to gatherings, sometimes the father is shaking hands and I'm already comfortable. That's against akhlaq of Islam. In Islam, I should not sit while my father is standing. He should be sitting first before I sit. That is one of the rules. Another rule, out of respect of the parents, do not let your parents to call you more than one time. It's against Islamic teachings. And tonight, brothers, let's understand the importance of the parent. You know, in Islam, our maraji, our fuqaha, they said, if you are praying salat nafila, not wajib, nafila, right? And your mother calls you, they say you are allowed to cut the prayer and attend to your mother. Salat. You're talking to Allah. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Mali. Your mother calls. Fuqasa, you are allowed to cut the prayer and attend to your mother. And the same applies to your father too. I want to fast, mustahab fast. In the month of Sha'ban. In the month of Rajab, mustahab. My mom tells me, no, I don't want you to fast. Allah said, I don't want that fast either. If you fast, Allah said, that fast it means nothing to me. Why? Because your parents are not happy. Mustahab salat, mustahab fasting is not allowed if your parents didn't approve it. That is the importance of the parents in Islam. That is how much Islam has given our parents that importance. Not only that, the importance of the parents come to in Quran in so many places. Brothers and sisters, do you know we read Quran every day and we read Surah Al-Baqarah. Do we know why Surah Al-Baqarah is called Surah Al-Baqarah? Surah Al-Baqarah is called a chapter of cow. But do you know that the surah is called Surah Al-Baqarah because of a child who was honoring and respecting his parents? Allah named the entire surah out of that child because of the respect of the he given to his parents. Now let me share with you the story. How did Surah Al-Baqarah become Surah Al-Baqarah? You know, at the time of Prophet Musa alayhi salam, there was a man who was very rich, very wealthy. But the man didn't have a child or wife or anybody except his nephew. He was the only one left among the entire family. And back in those days, it's written in Torah that if a person has money or a person dies, then the closest past person should be the one to inherit. And in this case, it's supposed to be the nephew. So the nephew was waiting when this uncle is going to die so he can inherit everything. Months passed by, the uncle didn't die. He was looking at the clock. When is he going to die? The uncle is still alive. So he decided to take the uncle's life. So if you're not dying fast, I will send you faster so I can get the money. So what happened? He went and find a place where the uncle normally passes, and he came and attacked the uncle from the behind and killed him. When he killed the uncle, he took the body, he dumped it on the street and started screaming, "Somebody killed my uncle, help me." But Israel came and they saw, yes, the man is killed. Now what happened? Who killed him? But Israel divided into two. One group said, "This guy looks suspicious. It looks like he killed the man." The other group said, "No, how can you say that? Have you seen him? Did you see it? How can you accuse him?" Bani Israel divided into two. Some are with the brother, some are not with him. Now what happened? They went to Musa alayhi salam. "Ya Musa, we have an incident here. We need your help." "What is it?" Somebody got killed. "We want you to come and resolve this matter." Prophet Musa came, and really he saw the man was killed. "How are we going to do this?" "Ya Musa, resolve it." "What do you want?" They said, "We want to find the killer who killed him before we bury him." They said, "Okay." You know, today we have all the detectives. They come and do all the detections and everything. They found it. Musa alayhi salam, he has a better detector. Guess who is his detector? Allah. Musa said, "Okay, I'll ask Allah. Ya Allah, I want you to help me to find the killer of this man." And Allah told him, "Ya Musa, if you want to find a killer, you can find a killer in one way, and that's it." "What is it?" He said, "You have to tell Bani Israel to find a cow." "Cow?" "Yes." Musa go to Bani Israel. "Ya Bani Israel, inna Allah ya'murukum an tadhbahu baqara." Now look at this verse, huh? Allah says, Allah ordered you to slaughter a cow. Which cow? Didn't matter. Just a cow. Go find it. Bani Israel, after they told to find a cow, they went back to Musa. "Ya Musa, question. What is it?" "Which color did Allah want?" Just mention a cow, but he didn't mention a color. Okay. Musa said, "Okay, I'll ask Allah. Ya Rabbi, ma lawnuha." What is the color? Surah Al-Baqarah is mentioned in there. "What color do you want them to slaughter?" "Qala innahu yaqulu innaha baqaratun safra faqi'un lawnuha tasurru an-nadhirin." Now listen to careful to all this description that Allah is giving. Baqaratun safra, a yellow looking cow. Safra, faqi'un lawnuha, very very pure color. Faqi'un lawnuha tasurru an-nadhirin, very nice looking for anybody who looks at that cow. Okay. Bani Israel, now you got the color. Yes. "Ya Musa, another question. What is it?" "Should it be a cow that has been used for farming or never been used for farm?" Allah said, "No problem. We tell you." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Ya Musa, tell them. وَلَا تَسْكِ الْحَرْثَ مُسَلَّمَةٌ لَا شِيَّةَ فِيهَا." Right? I will give them three descriptions. Good. But Israel, they went all around. In Egypt, they couldn't find the cow. They couldn't find it. Yeah, Musa, the description you gave does not match any cow ever in the country. So what are we going to do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya Musa. Musa said, Ya Allah. This is what Bani Israel said. They couldn't locate the cow. So what should we do? Allah said, Ya Musa, tell them to go to Palestine. In a city called so-and-so. In a place, there is a cow that matches that description. And let them buy and bring it. Okay. They got the description. They went to that city. Exactly the same cow that Allah told them is there. They bought the cow. They came back to Egypt. Ya Musa, we found the cow. Allah said, Fadbahuha. Slaughter the cow. He slaughtered the cow. Then Allah SWT said, take part of the meat and go and strike the dead man. That rich man who died, strike him. He will come back to life. And Allah said in the Quran, فَقُلْنَا ضْرِبُوهُ بِبَعْضِهَا كَذَلِكَ يُحْيِي اللَّهُ الْمَوْتَى. After they slaughtered the cow, he took part of the meat, they touched the body of this dead man, and he came back to life. And between the parentheses, you know what this means? Tawassul, huh? Tawassul we talked last night, that's what it is. Does Allah need a meat to raise somebody back? That he says, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ. Okay, now he says, a cow, slaughter, take the meat, touch. Why? Tawassul. The man came back to life. They ask him, Musa asked him, مَنْ قَتَلَتْ. Who killed you? He turned and looked at his nose. He, guess what? And he went back dead. Case closed. Right? They buried him. They found the killer. Everything is over. Musa said, Ya Rab, I'm still curious about the whole thing. What is it, Ya Musa? He said, Ya Rab, we have many, many cows in the world, right? But you did not give any description of any of these cows except this one. I want to know what is the sir? What is the reason? Then Allah said, Ya Musa, you want to know why? Say yes. He said, that cow belongs to one young man. That young man, he was a very, very dedicated child to his father. How was he dedicated? They said, this young man, his father was sleeping and he put that cow on sale. He put it for sale. Somebody came to buy the cow. They priced everything. He went to the house to pick up the key. He found his father is sleeping and the key is under that pillow. So he started thinking, should I wake my dad? Or should I wait until he wakes up? If I wait, I'm going to lose the customer. If I wake him up, I'm going to interrupt his sleeping. Now which one should I do? He said, I am not going to interrupt my dad out of respect for him. He went back and told the buyer, he said, if you're going to wait, you can get the cow. But until my father wakes up, you can come back. If not, you can go and I'll find somebody else to buy. The buyer said, no, I'm sorry, I can't wait. I need the cow so urgent, so I'm going to go somewhere. He said, okay, man, no problem. The father woke up later. The child told him the story. The father was so unhappy about what happened. And he prayed for the child. He said, oh my son, for the way you respected me and you honored me, I ask Allah to send you a good customer that will buy this cow for you. After days passed by, Allah accepted the dua. When the case of this man came, Allah took the description of that cow as the man or the young man, as he lost the customer, Allah said, I am going to send you the customer. And not only I'm going to bring you a customer, I'm going to mention your story in the Quran. And it's going to stay till the day of Qiyamah. That is why Surah Al-Baqarah becomes Surah Al-Baqarah. When you read the surah, entire surah is because of a child who honored his parent. That is the importance of this surah and the importance of the parent. And you know, in Islam, brothers and sisters, when Islam tells us to respect our parents and honor them, if you don't want to listen to anything, but just listen to this. And let this become take-home message. If I don't respect my parents because of Allah or Prophet or any reason, but listen to this one thing. And that is, you have to understand that Allah created this world with the system. And that system works under the control of Allah, not you, not me. And the system is, whatever you plant is what you're going to sow. That's, you have to get this in your mind. This has nothing to do with the Quran or Allah. Just something to think about. You can never plant the seed of apple and expect orange. Can you do that? I'm going to take the seed of apple and plant it, but inshallah it's going to be banana. No, Allah doesn't do that. Whatever you plant is what's going to sow, right? Good. So now if you sow the plant of respect for your parent, guess what's going to happen? Automatically your children are going to grow in respect of you. If you sow the disrespect of your parent, you can never expect the respect from your children. That is the custom that you have to understand. Even if I'm not going to respect my parents because of Allah, but keep this logic in your mind, because this is a system that Allah created. And let me end this with hadith that is mentioned in the book called Manazilul Akhirah, written by one of the great scholars. Who? Abbas al-Qummi. Abbas al-Qummi, the author of Mafatih al-Jinan. He has another book called Manazilul Akhirah. Manazil al-Akhirah is a book he wrote. In that book, he wrote an incident that happened to a young man at the time of Rasulullah, who hurt his parent. This young man was very religious, praying, fasting, doing everything you can think of. But one thing is missing, which is his mother was not happy with him for whatever reason. This young man was in his deathbed. His brothers and family were sitting around him, and they told him, say kalima to shahada. He can say anything, but the moment he said, something blocks his throat, he cannot finish it. They try him first, second. There is something there. They went and called Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah, we have an issue. What is it? I said, this young man is mu'min, is mutadayyin, is practicing, but this is what we have at this moment. He is dying, but we have this issue. Can you help us? The Prophet came and he looked at him and he said to him, Qul, say, Ashhadu al. He said, he cannot say the word. The Prophet repeated again. Can you say? He can't. Third time, he can't say it. Then the Prophet asked, is his father alive? They said, no, Ya Rasulullah. What about his mother? They said, yes, she's alive. Then the Prophet said, I want to talk to the mother. Then the mother came. Ya Rasulullah, what's the matter? See, I want to know what's the issue between you and your son. The mother said, Ya Rasulullah, there's nothing. He's a good son, praying, fasting, all kind of things he's doing. Brother said, yes, but there is something I can see. Then the Prophet asked the young man, he said, tell me, what are you seeing right now? The young man said, Ya Rasulullah, I see a man coming to me, very scary, very looking bad, very bad smell. Ya Rasulullah, I need your help. The Prophet said to the mother, look, your son, if he dies in this situation, he's going to Jahannam. If you forgive him, Allah will forgive him too. Then the Prophet asked the mother, would you forgive him? The mother said, yes, Ya Rasulullah, I will. Then the mother said, Ya Rasulullah, I forgive him. The moment she said, I forgive him, the young man said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Then the Prophet asked him, what can you see now? He said, Ya Rasulullah, the man that was I saw, he was coming towards me. He has turned, he's going. And now I saw another one coming with the nice looking. Then the Prophet says, Inshallah, your Jannah is guaranteed. Now Abbas al-Qummi made a very important note. And he says, look at how scary disrespecting parents can be in Islam. To the point where even Rasulullah could not help him without the mother forgiving him. Rasulullah came, but he couldn't help the young man. Until the mother forgave him, the Prophet could not do anything. Because there are certain sins, Shafa'a does not cover them. One of them is disrespecting your parent is part of the things that does not include in Shafa'a. Not only that, in Hadith, we have narration said that one of the sins that cuts somebody's life in half is disrespecting your parent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes He gives you a life 100 years, 80 years. When I disrespect my parents, then Allah cut your life shorter than that. And there is one dua from our Imam Zain al-Abidin, salamullah alayhi. When he said in that dua, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min dhanbin tu'ajjilu al-fana'. Ya Allah, I seek refuge in you from the sins that perish me quicker. Makes me die faster. Then they ask, what sins makes a person die? He says, uququl walidain. Disrespecting parents. And this includes whether my parents are dead or alive doesn't make difference. Because sometimes I can be respectful for my parents until they die. When they die and I forget them, I don't do something for them, you also be considered a disrespectful child to your parent. Because even in the barzakh, your parents write still on your shoulder that you have to do things for them. Because there is a qissa that is mentioned that there was an alim who died. This alim was very, very knowledgeable. Another alim saw him in the dream. He was sitting with the ulama in barzakh. But that one alim was not happy. Other ulama were happy and they were talking, but this alim was quiet. Then the alim who was still alive and he was the one seeing the dream, he asked the alim who was quiet. He said, why are you quiet? Why are you not happy like other ulama? Then that alim was in barzakh. He said, because I have nobody to send me something from the world to this barzakh. Then he asked him, don't you have a children, family? He said, yes, I have one son. But he never mentioned or do something for me. Then he asked him, do you know where your son is? He said, yes. He gave him all the description where he can find the son. The next morning, this alim woke up. He went there and he found the son. And he said to the son, why don't you do something for your father? I saw your father in the dream and he was not happy. Can you do something for him? The child says, Ya Alim, I don't have anything. I'm struggling. I don't have enough. That's why I haven't done anything for him. Then the Alim said to him, you can do something as simple as giving water as a sadaqah on behalf of your father. This water. Make a niyyah as a sadaqah on behalf of your father and your father will get that thawab. He said, okay. The next morning, the young man took a glass of water. He made a niyyah. This is a sadaqah on behalf of my father. And anybody he wants to give, he said, no, I don't want it. Everybody he gave, say, I don't want it. He said, okay. Ya Allah, you saw I did my best. Nobody took the water. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take it and pour it in a sea. He took the water to the sea. Right at the shore, he dropped the water. He poured the water on the floor and went back home. Few days later, this alim who was still alive, who saw the dream, he saw the alim again in the dream. But this time, he was so happy. Then the alim who saw the dream asked the one who was marhum, your son did something for you? Say yes. What did he do? He said, my son took a glass of water to give sadaqah on my behalf. But nobody took it. And he took the water to go and pour it. As he took the water to go and pour it, at the time that he poured, there was a fish which already came out of the river and was struggling to get back into the river. Then when he poured the water, it pushes the fish back to the water, and Allah took them him as a sadaqah. And Allah... Then Allah gave me one of the maqam in barzakh, and that's why I'm happy. Your marhumin, don't forget them just because they are not longer in this world. Tonight, let's learn the importance of the parents and the relationship between the parents and their children from four mothers in the Kerbala. And let's all of us be like them. If I don't have good relationship with my father or mother, let tonight be a turning point that I'm going to change. Not because of anything, because of those children in Kerbala. They taught us a lesson. There are four mothers in Kerbala. All of those four mothers, they lost their children on the day of Ashura. And all of them, they were happy that their children listened to them and obey them. One of them is Umm Layla. One of them is Umm Rabab. One of them also is Umm Farwa. One of them is Zainab Salamullah alayhi. All of these mothers, they are amazing. Not to think they don't love their children. They love their children like every mother. But they saw something that is more important than their own children, which is saving Imam Hussein and saving Islam is more important. The narration said, Zainab Salamullah alayha, on the night of Tasu'at Ashura, she called her two sons, Aun and Muhammad. And she said to them, Ya Aun and Muhammad, you know tomorrow is Ashura. Your uncle Hussein might not be alive. But I want to know, what are you thinking? What are you going to do tomorrow? Allahu Akbar. Then Aun and Muhammad said, Mother, we are willing to sacrifice for our uncle Hussein. Then Zainab Salamullah alayha, she said to them, I want you to do exactly that, so you can clean my face in front of our mother, Az-Zahra, salamullah. You know, Zainab, salamullah, she's called Ummul Masaib, right? Ummul Masaib, why is she called Ummul Masaib? Now listen carefully, brothers and sisters. Ummul Masaib, because Zainab, salamullah, alayha, she lost her mother in a tragedy when she was a little daughter, a little child. When she saw her mother, Zahra, was smashed between a door and a wall. And she didn't have a mother to grow up. She only had the only Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, who she loved as a father and a mother, who was playing the role of a mother and a father at the same time. Now she was grieving the loss of her mother. Suddenly she heard that Imam Ali was struck in Masjid al-Kufa. Imam Ali alayhi salam was being brought to the house. Imam Ali, for the first time, he was carried in his life by Hassan and Hussein. But when they came to the entrance of the house, Imam Ali said to Hassan and Hussein, Nazziluni, I want to walk myself to the house. They asked, why, ya Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen? He said, I saw Zainab behind the door. She is crying and I don't want to break her heart. So I want to walk inside the house so at least she feels some comfort. 3 days later, she lost her father, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Now no mother, no father. Now she had Hassan and Hussein. Now years passed by. She was also tragically, so her brother Hassan was poisoned. A poison, Imam Hussein said, they don't even give to the worst animal among the Arabs. they gave it to Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Imam Hassan was throwing blood and blood and blood to the point where Imam Hussein has to tell Zainab, please don't come in, because I don't think you can take the scene that I seen my brother into. After that, Imam Hussein alayhi salam and Zainab alayhi salam, they both lost Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Now Musiba of Zahra, she's still grieving. Musiba of Imam Ali, now Al-Hassan alayhi salam, now she was left with Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The only and the one brother that was left. Now on the day of Ashura, she is listening that they will kill her own and one left brother. Now she has to sacrifice not her brother, her two sons, Sa'una and Muhammad. The narration said on the day of Ashura, Aun and Muhammad were standing when Imam Hussein was calling, Hal min Nasirin Yansuruna, Hal min Mu'inin Yu'inuna. Zainab alayhi salam, she called Aun and Muhammad, can you come here? They came. She asked them, why are you still standing there? Why you are not going to go and bright my face in front of your grandmother Fatima alayhi salam? Aun and Muhammad says, ya Ummah, our mother, we've been asking our uncle Hussein from early dawn up to now, he doesn't permit us to go. Can you do talk to Hussein to allow us to go to the battle for? Fatima Zainab alayhi salam, she went to Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, you know I've been like a mother to you all this time, right? Imam Hussein said, yes, you have been. Then she said, why didn't you allow my children to go to and sacrifice? Then Imam Hussein said, ya Zainab, you know they are not baligh yet. It's not wajib upon them. So I don't want to tell them to go to the battlefield because it's not wajib. Then Zainab salamullahi alayha, she said, ya Hussein, you are sacrificing Ali al-Akbar, your son, and I will not sacrifice my children. Please allow them to go and sacrifice and allow them to go and become shuhada of Kerbala. Allahu Akbar. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he then put his hand on the shoulder of Aun and Muhammad and said to them, ya Aun, ya Muhammad, I give you permission to go to the battlefield. Aun and Muhammad, they went to the battlefield. They fought and fought as they were working together, because Abul Fadl Abbas is the one who trained them, and they were very strong in their fight, until Umar ibn Sa'ad said to his soldiers, I said, do not let these two children to fight along each other. Can you separate them and surround them and fight them? Allahu Akbar. They surrounded Aun and Muhammad. The spears started flying towards them. The swords started flying until they killed Aun and Muhammad. When they fell on the ground, they said, Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. Imam Hussein alayhi salam and Abu al-Fadl, they rushed to them. They picked them up. They look at them. Aun and Muhammad, they were still breathing. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he asked Aun and Muhammad, what do you have to say at this final moment? Do you have anything you want me to do? Then they said, Ballag salamana ila ummuna Zainab. All we want is send our salam to our mother and tell her that we have done exactly what she asked us to do. Is she happy with us tonight? Allahu Akbar. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he busted into tears by hearing Aun and Muhammad. When the news got to Zainab that her two sons died, she took a prayer rug and she faced towards the Kaaba and she did sajda and she said, Allahumma taqabbal minna hadha al-qurban. Ya Allah, accept this sacrifice that we gave. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu.